Nicole?
Yeah.
Oh, God.
Well, I mean, we don't want to push. Do you have something to tell us?
Well, no, I told you a story after your little discussion about the beach, the private beach. You know, I went to the beach this weekend.
Oh, yeah.
I was reading a book. Brian, do you remember somebody gave you a series of books, the Sleeping Beauty books?
Yes, yes.
Okay. Written by Anne Rice, right, who wrote The Interview with the Vampire and all those other things.
Right, now, I love her.
She's creepy cool.
Okay,
I love her. Now, I was in the middle of a book, so you took them home?
Actually, I got a copy of the first one, The Claiming of Sleeping Beauty. She wrote these books under another name.
They're very sexy, very passionate. Yeah.
They are not only sexy and passionate, they are filthy dirty.
Baby!
Can I borrow one?
Filthy, dirty. Yeah, when I'm done with that. And I'm almost done because I read most of it on the beach on Saturday.
So you were on the beach reading this book Saturday?
Yeah.
Uh-huh.
And sunning myself. And, yeah, very sexy, filthy, dirty book.
Yeah.
Yeah. And that's all. Read the book. On the beach.
Nicole?
Uh-huh.
Do you have anything to tell us? What?
Not really. Read the book on the beach. Dirty, really.
Do you have anything dirty to share with the 43?
Well, it was an exciting book, you
mm-hmm
know.
Tell us all about it.
Crowded beach.
You're reading the book. You're on the beach. Crowded beach. Lots of people around.
Rolled over, you know, get sun on my back.
Still reading?
Still reading.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
How was the sand that was beneath you?
You know how sand can be under that blanket.
It can be lumpy.
It can be very, very lumpy.
It can sometimes have ridges
like
and valleys.
Little mountains, little teeny little hills.
And you can actually feel them from beneath
when you're
the
sunning
towel.
So when you're sunning,
right,
especially when you roll over,
right,
sometimes it can be painful.
And sometimes not.
Mm-hmm. It's amazing how I just rolled over. Didn't, you know, position myself in any particular way, but boy, there it was.
What?
Oh, a mound of sand.
Did
really?
You did you screw the beach?
You know, I barely moved. Barely moved because there were lots of people around.
But,
yeah.
Notice she barely moved.
Now you're wearing a swimsuit, right?
When you're
doing it?
Yeah.
Now, you know, the one thing that enters my mind, because I know this may happen to me if I rolled over and I was, you know, jizzing all over the beach. I would, I could just walk by you and I could see you and your little butt cheeks from behind going.
You know, I was so mortified that somebody would know. And I turned around, no one's paying any attention to me. And I mean, like I said, I barely moved, but.
Did you?
You know when you get that shudder?
Did you?
Oh, yeah.
Oh, yeah?
Oh, yeah. Oh.
So you're reading the book.
Yeah.
You're hunching a mound of sand under your blanket.
You know, the expression that comes to my mind is sand wiener.
Hey. Hey. So, did you make the ultimate?
Yeah.
So it must be nice to make it on the beach like that.
Wild, knowing that there are so many people around and nobody had a clue what was going on. And I'm reading this book. And if anyone saw a book I was reading, The Claiming of Sleeping Beauty. I mean, unless they knew, they wouldn't know.
So most people.
Let me ask you this. Did the beach even ask you for your phone number afterwards?
No.
Wow, sorry, man.
Story of my life.
Okay, so now most people, they're reading this really dirty book. They roll over. There's a mound of sand. They hunch it a bit. They come across the big O for themselves. And they think, how cool. They'd probably stop there and go home. But,
What happened was I meant to bring this other book and I forgot, and so this is the only book I had, and it was the only thing I had to read on the beach, so I kept reading it, and about another 20 minutes later.
No, wait a minute, there was more?
Oh, yeah.
Two for you?
Two.
Right there on the beach. Yeah, boy, hey, how about
that? It was an exciting Saturday.
Well, of course it was.
So yeah. Santa Monica Beach is looking over to Palos Verdes going, hey, you got two! Hey, woohoo! Hey, you got two, man!
Oh,
yeah, and don't think us guys are gut shot. I mean, a beach is able to accomplish for you what many men haven't done in a lifetime. So fine.
You know, really, you know, that's a good observation. We go to beaches, guys do, to look at beautiful women, to try to find beautiful women.
You bet.
To take out beautiful women.
You bet.
Not only do we have to look at you, now we have to look at you pleasing yourselves.
Guess you don't need me.
But you wouldn't know. Nobody knew unless they happened to probably catch my face at that very moment.
But no, you had to have some sort of movement down south.
Oh, she did.
I'm sure I did.
I mean, just a little bit pinching together.
Exactly. And you can see it happening through her swim trunks.
I wasn't wearing trunks.
Oh, well, excuse me, whatever it is women wear, a bikini.
But see, and I did think about how women have such an advantage in something like this because we don't have the physical manifestations that men do.
You are correct. And at least as far as we know.
Yeah, but you can leave yourself a puddle.
Yeah, but you can't tell. Not like you can with a guy.
You did it twice?
Yeah.
Same hump in the sand there?
Uh-huh.
Same sand wiener.
Same sand wiener.
Yeah, boy. Well, congratulations. That's great that you can do that.
Ah, super.
Okay. I mean, we wish we could. That'd be nice. Boy, if we could, we wouldn't be up walking around looking for you people.
Yeah, we would. It's like, what, we're going to go to New Beach? I'm looking for some new. I'm looking for some fresh. I'm going to Malibu this time. I'm going to Malibu up there. Look for me a little hole in the sand.
All right, let's take a break. Baby. It's 7:30.
What's the name of this new? Before we go, do we have time to? Should we go?
We should go.
All right, there's a new condom out. It's called the Ultimate Condom or something. Did you read a story about this, Chuck?
Mm.
It's for women.
Oh, I saw one yesterday.
There you go.
You know, I did a thing yesterday with Athletes and Entertainers for Kids where it was called the 4th Annual Mothers and Daughters Tea,
mm-hmm.
where they matched up women from the community with these pregnant or teenage mothers, pregnant teens or young mothers, single mothers. And we went through a series of workshops, and in one of them it was about contraceptive and health, and they showed us this female condom that you insert, and
it's been on sale in a lot of other countries. It's just now been approved just last week for use in sale in this country.
Have you seen it? Have you seen this thing?
I've heard about it. Yeah, read something.
Okay, yeah. It's for the women, but it's
an inverted condom almost.
Exactly, yeah.
But I tend to get like a real ego, have an ego problem when I see this thing. It's like this long and this wide, this in diameter. It's like it's huge. It's like, is that what I'm supposed to be?
I don't think so.
Well, why would they make it that big then?
To cover all the area, maybe, or to compensate for the man.
Do you remember when she was on Good Times?
Yeah, I sure do. That's when we dated. That's when we were dating. That's when she decided she was going to lose the weight.
You can't even tell that was Janet Jackson.
And not only has she lost the weight, she's keeping it off.
Yeah, she is.
So that's a nice thing.
Through the miracle of
modern things. All right, Mike on three. Nicole seems to think that he might have saw you out there reading that book. Hey, Mike.
I knew we'd get a call like this.
Hey, Mike.
Howdy.
Now, are you sure it was her?
I am 100% sure. I've been to a couple of events.
All right, what color was, do you remember what color your towel was, Nicole?
Yeah.
All right, what color was her towel?
It was, it seemed to be mostly white, but there was like orange or streaks of orange or something.
Oh, my God.
And what color suit was she wearing?
I didn't pay attention to that.
Did you not?
I don't remember
she
that.
She was just watching the old.
Looking around the suit.
Now tell us, when you saw her.
Hey, just so you know.
You know what?
The suit thing, we didn't fill him out. I had to find out what color the towel was from Nicole. See? And then I told him.
Okay. You know,
I guess we should have conversed before this break.
I reckon it might have helped. I thought it was real.
It is real. No,
of
he
course
did.
It is.
But
this is real.
He did see it.
Did you? So you saw her on the beach. Did you notice whether she was on her back or her stomach when you saw her?
Well, she started out, she was sitting in a chair at first.
Were you sitting in a chair?
Yeah.
And it ended up, well, you know, at first we recognized her, and we thought, you know, we'll say hi. And then we noticed she was totally into this book.
Really?
Yes. And the most unbelievable thing is that my friend got really excited about it, and he ran back and got a video camera from his car.
No.
Absolutely.
Do you have this on video?
We have it on video.
You have her on video laying on her stomach?
Oh, Mike.
Do you have her on video laying on her stomach?
We do.
You have videotape, and you didn't even know this.
We did not get the facial expression, but she thought she wasn't moving, but she was.
You're saying, now hang on. You're saying on your video, you can see her actually moving a bit?
Yeah.
She was grinding.
A bit.
Now Channel 5 is going to call.
Mike,
yes,
you have to bring the video in.
Well, I've got big plans today, but I could get by there. What kind of player? This is on a video 8, high 8.
Do you have an adapter?
Yeah, I've got an adapter.
A regular VHS type of adapter?
Right.
Well, we've got the TV for that.
Okay.
Bring the adapter and the tape.
Hell, we're already getting axed for dude night.
Yes, we are.
We're getting some pieces of entertainment.
Well, my friend, who's very monetary oriented, was really working on how to get the most money from it, but I am a total fan of the show, and I just thought, this is...
Where were you sitting?
Well, at first, we were sitting a bit to your side, but we realized that you, a little bit, were looking each way to make sure, but you don't have eyes in the back of your head, and we thought that might be the most interesting vantage point, so...
Was it just you two, or were there people with you?
It was myself and a friend.
Nicole, all right, now listen.
Uh-uh.
Well, he says.
Uh-uh.
But answer this question for us.
Mm-hmm.
You're sitting in your chair reading this book.
Mm-hmm.
you're realizing that you're real turned on to this material that you're reading. Now, did you consciously think to yourself, you know, if I laid on my towel on my stomach, I might could bring something about? Did you think about that?
Not before? At first, until I turned over and there was that little mound right there.
And then you
the little mound of
whoa, sand.
Oh.
And then you consciously went for it.
Well, not even. I really didn't have to do much. And I don't believe Mike. Mike, I don't believe
him. Why don't you believe him?
That hurts.
Because
that hurts.
Because I looked around, and the only people that I thought that might have a clue as to what was going on, there were two guys and two girls sitting behind me. And the guys were oblivious, but I thought the girls knew.
No, obviously some guys saw it. But see, you were oblivious.
No, believe me, I was very because I would have been mortified if someone like caught me.
You'll be more mortified when you see the tape.
Yes, Mike, we got to see it.
You got to bring it in.
It's on its way.
And there's nothing, I guess, graphic Mike. About it, other than maybe you grinding your hips against the beach.
No, there's nothing graphic. I mean, but when it was just something that we noticed. All
Mike, right. Can you be here by the end of the show? Can you be here by 9?
Definitely.
You can.
No problem.
Oh my God, we're getting the video machine down here.
All right,
it's in creative service.
All right, we're gonna get the video machine, Mike. Now don't forget to bring the tape and the adapter for a VHS.
You got it.
Okay, man, we'll see you when you get here.
Alrighty.
All right, bye-bye.
$900 to you, Mike.
No.
Okay, I'll give it to my friend. He's a money hound.
You don't get $900.
All right, well, listen, Mike, bring it on down. We'll make sure you get a bottle bat at least.
You got it.
All right, man, see you then.
Nicole.
Oh, my God. You know, I'm more mortified of seeing myself in a bathing suit on video than the other thing. That I don't so much care about.
Nicole and Nicole sitting on the beach. M-A-S-T-U-R-E.
Nicole and the sand wiener lying on the beach.
Oh, that's good. That's good.
First comes the book, then comes the grind.
Oh, by the way, a lot of people have been calling asking what the book. It's Anne Rice. She did a series of 3 books written under another name, but in the bookstore, it's under Anne Rice. And the first one is The Claiming of Sleeping Beauty. And they're all, it's a series of Sleeping Beauty books, but you don't want to read these to your kids. And you also don't want to read them if you are easily offended, if you're shy about sex in any way, if you're not open to different things.
Obviously, you're not.
They are very erotic. And they're very, they're not for the squeamish.
Okay. Yeah. Well, see, now, out of curiosity, I got to find out what it is you're talking
it's
about.
It's the S&M kind of stuff.
Sure, out of curiosity.
It gets real hairy
you know,
points.
I tell you what, sexually speaking, I think, I like to witness, whether it be in video form or whether it be a novel or in person, I like to witness even those things that I thought I might be uncomfortable with to see what it does to me.
Can I tell you, this book would make the most erotic pornographic film. I mean, this...
But done right.
Have to be done right with a big budget, with like good actors, with you know high production values. I think that's what's missing in the pornographic film industry. I think this done right would be amazing.
Well, see, I tell you an example of that. The book Damage, Linda read and loved the book because it was a very well-written novel. However, it didn't transcribe to film.
Yeah.
So where it was, I found the film unerotic and very much not a turn-on and not that good a movie.
Yeah, I heard that from a few people.
So, I mean, you know, but she loved the book. Because like you say, reading a book can bring about a much better picture than in some cases a movie can.
You know, it's so funny that you had this experience on the beach. I mean, you actually reached the big O reading this book on the beach.
Twice.
Twice. In the sand. Because my buddy and I used to go to the beach all the time, and we'd look at these beautiful...
All the inside scoop.
Just like, oh, I wish I was at beach. And now... It's a sad day when a beach gets it more than I do.
A little gut shot.
Let's go to line 8.
Market Prime program, 6 minutes after 9 o'clock. We are very thrilled to have this lady in here. Anne Rice is here. Her new book that just came out is called Lasher. We're not going to read any passages from it. But you have just, you know, created quite the stir. My first question for you. The first time you wrote, I guess your first book was...
Interview with the Vampire.
Okay, yeah. That was 74?
I wrote it in 74. It was 76 when it was published.
What were you doing then? Were you...
I was just writing. I didn't have any occupation.
You wanted to be a writer?
Yeah. Okay. I was just a bum who wrote.
Had you ever written anything like that before, or did you sit at the typewriter one night and just, oh my God, look what's coming out of me?
It was a bit like that. I had been writing constantly, all kinds of short stories and things, but when I hit that comic book character, the vampire, suddenly I was able to tell everything I wanted to tell. And touch everything I wanted to touch.
And
it was like a miracle. It was just a whim, you know, to interview a vampire. And it was just like magic.
It became fun?
Oh, yeah. It was. It's not fun because it's too dark to be fun, but it's very, very exhilarating and thrilling.
Mm. Now, in the book Interview with a Vampire, you put some erotic, and that might be the wrong word, but you put visions to what it must be like to be a vampire into words that many people who have written about vampires for hundreds of years have never really thought about. And that's one of the interesting things, because vampires, boy, they've been written about and done to death, but yet you've put another angle on there that makes it most interesting to read.
Mm-hmm. Well, it really was an instinctive exploration. What would it be like to drink blood? Would you get the person's thoughts and soul as you drank the blood? You know, how if that was your whole focus, wouldn't that be erotic? Wouldn't that be the only intimacy that you would know? And it was just a great exploration for me. But I do think in old vampire literature, there's always an erotic overtone. Mm-hmm. There were erotic overtones in Carmilla and in Dracula. They were there, but that was just an age where people could not write as explicitly. So it's all veiled.
It was very sexy.
But there's always that implication that the bite of the vampire is going to bring rapture, and that there's something repulsive yet absolutely irresistible about that figure.
One of the other things that's interesting is that with your two main characters at the beginning of the book, one has just become a vampire. Lestat has been a vampire for a long time.
Right.
And the grasp with which the new one hangs on to mortal life before finally, I'm assuming, letting go, because I'm just at that point. I'm just...
Yeah, Louis. Yeah, that's exactly right. He's sort of inducted into it by Lestat, and it's quite a struggle. And then once he gives in, there's great regret and great guilt, you know, which Lestat doesn't feel. I mean, Lestat starts off sort of a galloping hero, and he's that way for the next three or four books, you know. He's my hero who doesn't regret. He just goes forward. But Louis was the great regretful character.
Mm-hmm. Would you mind calling the producers of the upcoming movie and suggest that we play Lestat?
Oh, I would love to, but I don't think they'll take my call. But I certainly would. I wish you would.
Are you kind of on bad terms with them?
No, not really. Because just don't have any communication.
You like it that way?
Kind of, because I think it's a collaborative art form, and every day they change something in Hollywood, and I'd rather not know. You know, I'm very single-minded.
Was it hard for you? I mean, you made money on it, and assuming it's going to be good work, but through someone else's eyes, of course. Was it hard for you to let go of that?
Yeah, it's hard now. Like, I understand that they've started shooting in New Orleans. Maybe today they've actually started shooting. And it's very exciting to me, but it's very painful. At last it's happening. Something's going to happen, but it's not going to maybe live up to our expectations, or I don't know. You know, 16 years we've been fooling around with Interview with the Vampire in Hollywood, and at last it's being done.
Now, on one hand, we know that you're displeased with the choice of Tom Cruise as Lestat.
Yeah.
Now, on one hand, you've got one of the hugest names in the business that will be the star of your film. But you have such a... well, you said in the interview he's one of the best actors we have today. However, he is not my Lestat.
That's right. Yeah. Well, the readers are furious. I mean, from coast to coast, they are furious. They've been coming up to the signings and just say, what can we do about it? How can we change it? He's not the right person for this role. So a great deal of what I've said reflects what they feel.
Also,
and I feel that way, too. I don't think he's the person at all for the role. But I do think it's terrifically exciting that Brad Pitt is going to be in this movie. He's actually playing the lead, Louis. Mm-hmm. That's technically the lead of Interview with the Vampire, the teller of the tale, the witness. And I think Brad Pitt's going to be fabulous. Mm-hmm.
It's a tribute to the writing of a book when the readers get all upset because someone is cast in a role that is not in their mind the image. So it must have been... your character, all of your characters, but this one especially, very descriptive. You picture him in your mind. And the people who've come to me and said, Tom Cruise, I can't believe it. I said, well, why? Well, because he's this, and this. And they all say about the same thing.
Yes, that's true. And I've been very heartwarmed by that, you know, that they cared about that character became real for them as he was for me. I'm very warmed by it. It's really just you know, a great thing, but it's also distressing because nobody can imagine how that movie is going to turn out. But Neil Jordan's the director. Neil Jordan's a brilliant man. He's made great movies. I thought The Crying Game was fabulous. The Company of Wolves, Mona Lisa, The Miracle. I think he's a good guy. So obviously he sees something in Tom Cruise we don't see, so we'll see what happens.
You've mentioned in other interviews that sometimes you scare yourself.
Yeah,
I mean,
I do.
When I don't read horror very often, but when I do, and I sometimes have to put down the book. Mm-hmm. Is it a situation where you're writing at your typewriter and I gotta leave? I'm scaring. Well, it's just too frightening.
It's not that I gotta leave. It's that I don't dare. You know, I don't want to go out of the room if there's nobody in the house. I'm suddenly completely freaked.
And you scare yourself.
Stay
wow.
right there. Yeah, that's true.
And now, when you're writing and you're sitting in front of your computer and you're writing all your stuff down, some of the words that pour out, are they the spur of the moment type of thing, or do you think about what you're going to write kind of before you go into the room?
Oh, no, I want it very much to be spontaneous. I want to tap into something, and there's an enormous amount of control coming from the brain, but I very much get into this flow. I would compare it to sports almost, you know, to starting to dance, or to, not dancing isn't a sport, but I mean, boxing, something, I don't know, you go with the whole way it feels.
So you're not looking up the thesaurus for another word for hump or anything?
Well, every now and then. Yeah. I've used hump three times.
Yeah, let's use something else.
I have a little...
Gee, I just used hump.
God, you know.
Slam. When you're working on a new project and it doesn't feel like it's flowing, do you put it on the shelf and just start at something else?
I do. Sometimes it just don't work. I wanted to do this novel in the Frankenstein tradition, where I wanted to do a sort of modern version of the synthetic man. I just couldn't get the voice right, so I put it aside.
You just couldn't get the voice right?
I couldn't get the voice of the book right. I couldn't get into it. Couldn't get the main character talking. Couldn't find
it. Will you return someday? Or?
Oh, yeah. Or use a great deal of it in other books. Like in Lasher, for example. Lasher is a sort of separate species of being, and so... And kind of born yesterday, and there's a great deal of world and being educated by everything he sees, and yet being a baby mentally.
You know what? It's interesting to see what's happening to you with your books and the progress of what you've done. Is the more you write, the more there is to write, it seems, with you.
I think there is. That's true. I'm asking of horror fiction that it be everything. I'm saying there's no limit. You can sit down, and it doesn't make any difference if this is horror fiction. It doesn't make any difference if it's vampires, mummies, whatever. You can put everything you know in there. Every observation you've got about the real world, the imagined world, you can put it in there. Horror fiction can do that. It can be great. It can take everything that you know. There's no limit. And so it is that way for me. It's growing. It's all the time expanded, because I will not impose any limit on it. I will accept no limit. And in the beginning, you know, that was a bit of an outrageous premise, to write a book that's every character is a vampire. I mean, people said, you know, how can this be serious? What are you talking about? But that's over now. So
do you have rules for your writing? Do you, like, is it a rule you have to be in front of your computer at 8 in the morning
and
work until 5?
Or? I'm almost nowhere at 8 in the morning. No. I mean, I was really delighted to come here this morning.
You're looking good this early.
Thank you very much. No, I write when I want to write. You know, I often don't. If it's a bad day, you know, I don't do it. I read or think or walk around or go see one of my hundreds of cousins or one of my hundreds of aunts. Yeah, I have a huge Irish Catholic family. It's gigantic.
How does your work, how did it cross the line from housewives are reading this? You know, like you said in one of the interviews, a lady came up and said, I love it, and she put the book right next to her baby in the stroller.
Oh, yeah.
You're the first to cross this line.
You think so?
With this kind of material.
Well, I always secretly suspected that if women could get good pornography, they would read it, that they weren't very good at getting what they wanted, that men were much better, much more upfront about demanding and getting what they wanted, whether it was to go to a dominatrix in a brothel and have a wonderful scenario acted out for several hundred dollars, or whether it was to go find magazines and books what they wanted. Women, they tend to settle for what they're given, and my suspicion was that, you know, if I wrote this just the way I wanted, where you didn't have to mark the hot pages, every page would be hot, you know, that they would respond. But I wasn't really sure that would happen, and it did take a while. I mean, these books sort of were a cult thing for a long time. They were kind of secret. They have a big gay audience. They transcend gender. I mean, they're men with men, women with women.
You have to be for a vampire, as you said.
Well, I'm actually talking about the Sleeping Beauty books now, but the vampire books are basically the same thing. They are doing the same thing on a different level.
Did you read a lot of different pornography before beginning to write this kind of hardcore pornography that you write?
I did, but there wasn't very much. I'd go into stores in Berkeley, where I was living then, and say, where's your pornography section? And say, pornography? And I, being a child of the 60s, or, you know, coming of age in the 60s, to still believe in the sexual revolution, I say, yes, you're pornography, you know? And they say, we don't have that. That's not politically correct.
Right, now, in that you were frightened by your vampire interviews, do you find yourself erotically turned on by when you're sitting there writing whatever it is that you're writing, and most of it coming from your own imagination?
Yes, I do. It's also to test it that way. If it doesn't turn me on, I don't write it. But I'm turned on by a lot of things in all the books. And
anything in here, you see?
A thin line between the erotic and the just being like entranced.
Sure.
We got a few things we'd like to show you.
Oh, no.
One in particular. Yeah. Now, what is the reason for writing under several names?
The reason I published the erotica, that was the first pen name that I chose, was really because I was asked to do that by the people who published the Anne Rice books. And I also didn't want people to go out and buy these books just because of the name Anne Rice. I did have a following at that point. It wasn't what it is now, but it was faithful. And I thought, I want people to know this is actually pornography. So I labeled it with that name. I put a frame around it. Everyone knew I had written it, you know, everyone in the book industry and people all in my neighborhood and, you know, people all over the country. But I felt that that was the only way to do it. Also, my father was still alive and I didn't want him to know.
Because
really? He's an Irish Catholic, and I knew he to him, sex and murder are both mortal sins. Mm-hmm. You know, so I just didn't want him to be depressed or upset. I didn't want my sisters to be embarrassed. There were a lot of reasons like that, but I never denied for a second that I did it, and never really cared. At first, I wanted privacy too. I lived in the Castro in San Francisco, and I'd walk out every day and see all kinds of people, and I really didn't want them talking to me about Sleeping Beauty till I was finished with whatever I wanted to do with that. I thought that would block me if they came up and, you know, the vampires know. I mean, they would come up and say, we want Lestat back, or how could you do this in the book, or how could you do that? That was fine. But I didn't really want to talk about the... I wanted the pornography to really go the distance, and so I didn't want to be embarrassed or humiliated or inhibited or afraid. Mm-hmm. So a pseudonym gives you that freedom. You know, you're an anonymous person. Like, you know, if President Clinton wanted to play a saxophone and not be known as the president, and he slips off to a little bar and plays the saxophone.
Did we blow it for you that we mentioned that was actually you?
Oh, not at all. My name is on the stuff now. Yeah. No, I was delighted to hear that you all were reading it on the air.
Oh, yeah.
And I was thrilled. I thought that was great.
Are you... Does it frighten you? We've already talked about your market. What is your market, first of all? Women, I guess, basically, and now men are getting into it?
No. It's really, if you were to come to a signing like the one in Venice Beach yesterday, you could not tell what the market is. It's women, men, old people, young people, children. I mean, lots of teenagers now. It's very mainstream now. But it's also still counterculture and wild and crazy and heads and freaks.
Isn't there a section of your fans that you might be frightened of? A few that take it a little too seriously? Does that ever cross your mind?
I don't think so. I think, in fact, I get the impression that they know exactly what spirit it's all written in.
Most of them, I think.
The vampire groupies in particular, the ones that wear the fangs made by dentists and the black clothes and everything, they seem to understand totally that it's a kind of poetry. They're not Satanists.
And they're celebrating the
romance of it in the positive sense. I mean, they really love dressing up in their vintage clothes and going out with their white makeup and their fangs and sitting in cafes. You know, it's a thing in their lives, and they enjoy that. And now with the S&M, the people I've known that practice S&M were extremely wholesome people that gave lectures on hygiene and how to tie people up safely and how if you're going to use multiple locks, they should all have the same key. But, I mean, they were very health conscious.
That's a good idea, by the way.
All right.
Safety tip.
New rule. All right, Ann, got to know this. You marry your high school sweetheart.
Yes.
And you go through life with him, and everything is great. And so you sit down one day, and you start writing, and all of a sudden you come out with this claiming of Sleeping Beauty.
Yeah.
And I'm assuming at some point your husband sat down and read this
book. Oh, absolutely, right away.
The words and the scenarios that were described in this book, were they to him that you had the process with which to write like this?
No, he has a wild imagination, too.
And you had shared...
I mean, we're not...
Spanking each other all the time?
No, absolutely not.
But would you like to?
No.
But he did
absolutely
know.
Not.
But he did know of the imagination.
Absolutely. Oh, yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, and he approves of it totally. I mean, when we got married, it was 1961, and we believed in the sexual revolution. The sex was good. The fantasies were good, that you should explore who you were. That was one of the most important things that happened in the, you know, in the 30 years that we were married. And we never changed. I mean, one of the bewildering things is that so many of our liberal friends took such sharp turns to the conservative. You know, began talking about political correctness and, you know, people that had gone to court to testify in obscenity trials in the 60s for Allen Ginsberg or people like that so that he could use obscenities in Howl, his mm-hmm. poem, those people were now saying it wasn't politically correct to do this, it wasn't politically correct to do that, boycott Playboy, so forth. We just never changed our minds.
So they're
like
denying
that.
It. Those people are denying it instead of celebrating what happened then.
Well, certainly with pornography they are. You know, there's mm-hmm. a segment of the population that believes that you have to politicize your imagination. And if you're ever going to stop rape and literal violence, you mm-hmm. have to stamp out pornography. I don't believe that at all. See, I don't think pornography has anything to do with literal rape. And I think that our fantasies are worth exploring. And I don't think that reading these books leads people to go out and commit crimes. Far from it. I would think the crimes are being committed by people who don't read anything.
Helps them exercise it, if anything else.
Well, yeah, I would say, I don't know. You know, the one thing we know about criminals is when you interview them in jail is almost all have been really severely abused as children. Mm-hmm. You know, cruelty, I mean, mm-hmm. really knocked around. Mm-hmm. I think things like that are more relevant than what they read.
Yeah. Well, you know, speaking of the claiming of Sleeping Beauty, speaking for myself, I am a fairly involved individual in fantasy, and that particular book I really can't read because I find myself much too involved, and I would wind up bothering my wife 6-7 times a day.
Or going to the pet store buying a cat. And then stopping by the supermarket for some butter.
I was going to say, don't forget the butter.
Yeah, I'm going to get a butter, get some cat.
But, you know, in reading that, what you were just talking about was that you'll come across a scenario, and those of us that do like to fantasize quite often will think to themselves, hey, never thought about the handle of a knife.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it
you
really know,
you,
does.
You find yourself taking notes when you read it.
Hey, gotta do this.
I must remember this and use it later.
Gotta get in here with it.
Well, I think that's fine, too. Yeah. You know, mm-hmm. I really do. I think it's all terrific. It's all wonderful.
Yeah. So in a way, I guess it's a mark, another good mark for a good actor is you're kind of a teacher.
Am I?
Yeah.
Okay.
You open up a lot of minds, and fortunately, it's like we said, moved into the housewife genre. It's mm-hmm. moved into just people not saying, oh, that's a dirty book.
Yeah.
And they're not reading it secretly in a closet.
Uh-uh.
They're out there, and they're putting it on the coffee table because they're damn proud of it.
And
well, that seems to be the case, and mm-hmm. I feel really... what fortunate, you know, I'm sort of knocked out by that acceptance, and you know, we also fight to maintain on those books covers that allow anybody to buy them.
Mm-hmm.
And I don't want any explicit stuff that would make people a mark as they walk up to the register with that, like mm-hmm. why are you reading this, or mm-hmm. oh ho, you're reading this. So we keep these very tasteful covers on them, and I love that idea that anybody anywhere can buy one and carry one on the bus. And you know, only the others who know the book will know.
Right, that, right,
okay.
right.
You know, and then they'll
kind
go,
of a small knit group.
I heard this is good. all right, in 1961, you got married then?
Yeah.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Did you guys have money or you were...
No, we didn't have anything.
All right,
I think
good.
We had $50 when we came to California.
Then what's it like to sign something that says you're going to make $17 million here, take it? What's that like?
Sort of want to get to work right away, you know?
Give me the money!
No, it's an advance against... what you're going to write.
Right.
And there's a little bit of terror. You know, what if I can't write anything?
Mm-hmm.
But actually, basically, what that is a huge vote of confidence from your
sure.
publisher. You know, it's not like they give you $17 million and you can run away to Rio de Janeiro and never come back. I mean, mm-hmm. you have to write the books.
Mm-hmm.
And every author basically makes the same, 15% of the price of a hardcover book. What that is an advance against what they think they can sell. And
you got $17 million worth of advance.
For three books?
Well, you don't get it all at once. You get it as you turn in the books. It's a commitment that they will go with you that far. But you have to produce.
Well, when that contract is negotiated, do you give them, here's the ideas I have?
No, I didn't.
You say nothing.
No,
and just
no.
say, yeah, I'll write you three books.
That's right. Yeah. Whew. But it takes a while to reach that point, you know. I mean, they know that
mm-hmm.
They've been very happy with Lasher and very happy with The Witching Hour. And The Tale of the Body Thief, the last vampire novel. So they trust me, thank God.
And you've just become a household name maybe in the last year or two, but you've got to remember this was like 74 when...
Mm-hmm. Interview was published in 76.
Yeah, okay, yeah. So it's been a while.
It has. It had a cult life for a long time.
A what?
A cult. You
cult
know,
life.
Not occult,
the
but a
yeah.
cult
right.
following. And again, a big gay audience.
What was it like, you and your husband, you're cruising along, and you, like you said, you had $50 when you moved to California, and all of a sudden, one day, his wife becomes this hugely celebrated author mm-hmm. of some different type of material.
Mm-hmm.
How did both of you deal with the fact that you go from obscurity to a $17 million three-book deal?
Well, it happened over a period of time, and there were ups and downs. Mm-hmm. Like Interview with the Vampire made a great deal of money. Certain other books didn't. So we just travel with it. You learn. I tell you what happens in that. You learn what you want to do, and you learn what's valuable to you. Mm-hmm. You discover that certain things just don't matter to you.
Such as? What do you mean?
Well, one of the things that matters is to keep writing, no matter what. To absolutely keep writing, no matter what. And
no matter what, meaning if the idea, like, it's not flowing, but I'm going to get in there. And
yeah, I mean, if tragedy strikes, if illness strikes, if you get a bad review, if somebody comes up to you in the street and says, I hate your stuff, how dare you, mm-hmm. you know, to keep writing.
Is your husband in support of this?
Oh, absolutely, totally.
My 17 mil?
Hell yeah, come on.
No, I know this sounds ridiculous. My husband actually doesn't care about money. I mean, he doesn't know anything about it or care about it. He paints all the time and he works on his poetry. And if anything, more dedicated, really, than I am. I have a little bit more room for life in general than he has. He's totally recluse. And we're still, you know, college kids. I know that sounds stupid, but, I mean, we really are. We still have essentially the same values we had in the 60s when we were going to San Francisco State and UC Berkeley and telling ourselves we wanted to do something important and we didn't want to be dragged kicking and screaming into some sort of corporate life or, you know, job or something. I mean, we were always reminding ourselves of that, and it worked out.
Brings to mind the movie Big Chill, how they were all discussing around the table, we were all the rebels back then, mm-hmm. but look what happened to us now. Yeah. Doesn't seem to happen to you and your husband.
It hasn't. Yeah. It hasn't. We're very, very fortunate, uh-huh. and money enables us to be wild mm-hmm.
And
dress practical.
Like,
and
dress like Johnny Cash.
Dress like Johnny Cash.
So when you got money.
Yeah, you can do that.
I hadn't thought about dressing like Johnny Cash. Well, that's it. Yes, exactly. You're right. Mm-hmm. You know,
that's
true.
With Interview with a Vampire, Exit to Eden is also going before the cameras.
It's gone, too. I mean, it's shooting in New Orleans.
Dana Delaney.
Yeah, Dana Delaney and Paul Mercurio. And I have not seen a picture of Paul Mercurio yet, but everyone says he's absolutely gorgeous. He was in a movie called Strictly Ballroom, and he's Australian. Mm-hmm. So they say he's fabulous.
When the movie comes out and Tom Cruise gets the reviews, you'll see the movie, right?
I don't know. Maybe. Oh,
okay, if you do.
I will probably wait. You know, well, I will lie in my room as everybody else calls and says, da-da-da-da.
Well, you'll be the number one person everyone's going to want to ask. What did you think? Will you tell them if you see it? Will you be honest?
Oh, absolutely. Mm-hmm. I've been honest all along at the risk of alienating everybody involved in it, you know?
So there won't be, yes, I've seen it and I'd rather keep my feelings to myself?
Oh, no. Okay. No. Mm-hmm. I owe my readers the truth about this. I mean, it was the same with the Tom Cruise thing. I could have just said, you know, PR things for Warner Brothers. Well, you know, he really is a great actor and blah, blah, blah. But, I mean, I feel like if you're going to write S&M porn, you owe people the truth. Mm-hmm. You know, I don't respect writers in the past who didn't come out and say that movie was a piece of caca, mm-hmm. you know. Mm-hmm. It's just, I would definitely say it.
Also would assume that you've not spoken to Tom Cruise about your views.
No, I don't know that there's any access. I found out about Tom Cruise in the newspaper, just like everybody else.
So you're almost shut off from this production. You said earlier that you think they're shooting today.
We call them, and we periodically ask, and David Geffen has a wonderful assistant who keeps us posted on things when we call, but that's about it. I've met Neil Jordan, the director, a couple of times. I think he's really nice, but, you know, I'm out of it. I was out of it when I finished the script.
But you did write a couple of screenplays.
Yeah, I wrote the screenplay for David Geffen, and I told him at the time that I would write only what I wanted to write, and he agreed. It was actually a wonderful agreement. I handed it in. Now what they do with it, really, they have to do without me because I can't collaborate with
them. So you're going to be the screenplay writer?
Possibly. I think Neil Jordan's going to get shared credit, which means he must have changed it substantially.
So that will appear on the screen?
Apparently. Yeah, they won't determine that. You know, the Writers Guild of America will help them determine who gets the actual credit.
You know, whatever happens, no matter what people's opinions are, this is already a huge film and will be huge, mm-hmm. larger, when it finally does come out, because there's a lot of things to be answered by this mm-hmm. film.
Well, yeah, as far as publicity goes, this Tom Cruise thing really has helped it.
Mm-hmm. I imagine so.
Yeah.
I really do. I've been all over Canada recently signing books. I started this tour in Jackson, Mississippi, and then went up there, and everywhere people have said, we're going to go see it because we love the book and we want to see what they do. Mm-hmm. But they're very unhappy about Tom Cruise. Mm-hmm. So, but that tends to be their statement. We'll go see it anyway.
But that's got
to
make you feel good still.
It does, yeah.
You were so vivid in your story and description of this
man. I feel great about it. Yeah. You know.
So taboo. You've already hit, like Interview with a Vampire, you hit one area for me the other night that I couldn't believe you did.
Oh, really? What was that?
When Louis comes up on the crying little girl her mother mm-hmm. on the floor. I can't believe he took her.
Oh, well.
It's Louis. He didn't do that.
I know.
But he did. And Lestat yeah, knew he would, was watching right. in the window and laughing.
Right. That's Claudia, yeah.
I haven't got there yet. Took her Disneyland?
No. We're going to Disneyland!
Come on, honey.
No, I just, I mean, that is...
Everything's going to be all right, little girl.
That's right. She come up and sit on Louis' lap.
But it was such a taboo area. She was crying. Yeah. Her mother's dead. It's yeah. Louis, and he yeah. I couldn't believe it. I just got.
Oh, I was right there with him, and we
I
were standing there, and you know, I knew he would do that. I didn't know what was going to happen next. You have to understand. I didn't know the Scott was going to pop up in the window.
I thought he was going to help her or something, but no.
No, she was food, man. You know, right. I hate to say it, but there it was. You know, there
he
it was.
Was food.
The compassion and the allure and the beauty, and she was. Mm-hmm. You know, there. And
yeah.
I ponder that a lot in my writing.
All the way right,
those
well.
Desires mingle.
Made me sit up mm-hmm. here today.
So I guess family reunions, the kids stay away from you, huh?
No, it's what yeah. they do.
All right, we're going to take a quick break, come back, and then take some phone calls.
That's what we need, the country western beauty.
That's right, the country western beauty.
Mary Jo.
He's sort of a dedicated actor, movie monk already, mm-hmm. to use a phrase popularized by Eve Babbitt. But his whole life is movies and plays and acting. And I don't think he has got quite, you know, he gets bored by Interview with the Vampire, I think.
You're in a pretty cool position in that you can, since you're a writer, you can pretty much write when you feel, so you've still got time to be mom and wife.
Oh, yeah. But he's 15 now, and... we don't see him much, you know. We sort of lay in wait for him mm-hmm. after school to just see him for about 5 minutes.
See
he's
ya.
In a couple of plays, and he's rehearsing all the time.
Acting?
For those plays.
So he's
yeah.
into that.
Yeah, acting and singing.
Artistic family you have here.
It seems so, man. Mm-hmm. We're all obsessed. It's kind of nice.
Good, then.
Good.
Chris on 7. Hey, Chris.
Yes.
You're on the air.
Well, terrific. Good morning.
Hi.
Hi. And Ms. Rice, I've got to tell you, this is such a thrill to finally get to say... you know, how much I really, really enjoy everything you've done.
Oh, that's great. Thank you.
I've got to tell you, the Beauty series is brilliant. I read all 3 books in 1 weekend, and the people that haven't Dude. Tried it, oh, hey, they're great reading.
Is this brilliant. Evelyn Wood?
Well, let me put it this way. It's a great way to spend a weekend reading out loud to a significant other.
Oh, great.
Now that's
I
a,
love
yeah.
that.
Yeah, we had talked about that. That'd be a good thing to do. Read it out loud, little passages.
Yes, to your significant other. Perfect.
You're a wife?
No.
Okay.
All right, perfect.
So okay.
No. Well, got to wonder, if you read all 3 books in 1 weekend, are you still standing?
Well, we spent a lot of time laying down, I'll put it that way.
Bet you did.
Mm-hmm. amongst other positions.
Mm-hmm.
I absolutely loved it.
Oh, thank you so much.
With the Interview with the Vampire, I agree Tom Cruise is the last person on the planet that mm-hmm. I would pick.
Seems like
that.
It.
I know who I had in mind reading the entire series of books, and that was David Bowie.
Mm-hmm.
He's much closer to the character by physical, the ability to portray ominous and yet sensuous, this type mm-hmm. of cold-blooded.
And doesn't need much makeup.
No, he would not need much makeup. Plus, he could carry the costuming well. Who would your personal choice be for Lestat?
Well, Jeremy Irons was my choice.
Ooh,
and
perfect.
He's a bit old for the part, but he's such an incredible actor. I was sure he could do it, especially after seeing him in Damage.
Yes.
Which he was the sexiest man on the screen there. I think he would have been great, and his voice would have been great. David Bowie has a great voice also, and a great voice is very important for the mm-hmm. role.
Yeah, you know, I can see Jeremy Irons in that role. Okay, thank you.
My pleasure.
All right, let's go to... I don't have the sheet with me. Hey, just a moment.
Hello?
Hello?
Am I on the air?
Yes.
Hi, this is Tom Cruise. Hi, Ann.
You're kidding.
We finally get to talk.
You are joking, aren't you?
No.
Tom?
Yeah.
Where are you calling from?
Here. I'm in Los Angeles.
Well, that doesn't quite sound right
no,
to
I had
me,
to come
Tom.
In for a, I had to come in for this publication meeting. Ann,
mm-hmm.
what's the problem?
This is a nice try, but I don't think you're Tom Cruise. I'd have to see some identification.
Would you like to hear Johnny Cash?
Yeah, see if John's
no, I know Johnny Cash if he called. We could sing a duet.
Is John there, Tom?
All right, I'll be back in the studio.
All right, see you in a minute. Right. All right, let's go to...
you know what?
You mean that was...
Yeah.
Oh, God, you fooled me completely.
I liked your first response.
Devils.
I liked your first response. You're kidding.
Right.
No, speaking of devils, you've written about witches.
Yes, I got to work on the Tom Cruise.
you've written about vampires. What about the subject of it? It appears as though you lean toward things that could be a bit frightening in certain areas. What about exorcism and that subject, that area?
Pointy sticks.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, I haven't gotten into that too much. But in the witching hour, of course, there are times when the witches in the Mayfair family get possessed by the spirit Lasher, mm-hmm. and he takes them over and uses their bodies for a while. Mm-hmm. I think there's tremendous... not proof, but there's an enormous amount of testimony that people have been through that experience. They've been possessed by something. Now, whether it's their subconscious coming mm-hmm. up to mug them or it's really something from outside, I don't know. But I've watched fascinating films of possessions in Brazil. And
they're scary. I've seen some of this. This is very frightening stuff.
And we have Americans who go down there and say that they didn't believe it at all, and suddenly they jumped up at the middle of the candomblé, you know, ritual, and they became possessed. Don't remember what happened for 2 hours.
Well, it just seems as though you're a very simplistic way of describing what would be happening to a person that would be possessed. For example, when Louis first became a vampire, and Lestat mm-hmm. said, now, go off and empty yourself of your fluids and don't become infatuated with the moon or whatever.
Mm-hmm.
It would be most interesting to see how you would, like The Exorcist was a great book and and a good movie.
It was a great movie.
And it appears as though you'd be able to do real well with that particular subject. And other than what you just talked about, you haven't read or written anything on that particular subject yet.
No, just parts of it all the way through, different times when people are taken over by things.
All right, let's do Richard on 4, because you have one of these coming up, or just did one.
And you're writing a comedy musical right now, aren't you?
No.
About that. No?
Soon will, though.
Hey, Richard. I can see Oklahoma done by Anne Rice. Come here, Lori.
Sit on my lap, I'll show you something. You got a knife with you? Richard.
Yes.
You're on the air.
Yeah, good morning, everybody. My name is Rice. How are you?
Hi, I'm fine.
Oh, this is wonderful speaking with you. I'm a big fan of all the Vampire Chronicles, and I was just wondering, will you be doing any book signings in time soon here in Los Angeles?
Actually, I've done them.
You did?
Yeah, I'm on my way out.
So, oh, no. Yeah. Oh, so that we can't catch you right there at the studio then, huh?
No.
Oh, well, that's what I want to know, but I'm really... looking forward to reading the next one last year that you just released.
So, great, good.
So it was great talking to you, and thanks a lot.
Okay, take care.
Thanks for calling.
Bye.
Sharon.
Hey.
You're on the air.
Hi, Anne Rice.
Yes.
Really a pleasure to talk with you. I'm such a big fan. Read the book in 76, Interview, and preconceived ideas of who should have played the parts, and I just can't believe I'm talking to you.
Is this Tom Cruise?
Tom?
What I was going to ask was your inspiration for Interview with the Vampire. Did it come a lot from being in New Orleans? Because you totally just brought New Orleans together for me as far as wanting to go there, having to go there. And then when I got there, looking around every corner for Lewis or Lestat or somebody.
What a great choice of the setting for that.
Mm-hmm.
It's a frightening city anyway, kind of weird and mystical.
Mm-hmm. It's perfect. You walk around and it's just like it hasn't changed.
It's mm-hmm. a haunted city.
It is. Do you walk around in the morning much?
Yeah, I do. Take long walks in the morning and it's very beautiful.
Oh, it is. And in fact, I'm taking my niece there for Halloween.
Mm-hmm.
We're going to be staying right down on St. Charles Street
at
the Collins Hotel. Mm-hmm. And are you going to be in town?
No, I won't be there for Halloween.
Too bad.
But Louis will.
Okay, I'll be looking.
Take that niece over to see Louis.
I'll be looking for him, definitely. And also, one other question, witching hour. I had heard that your house was...
It's the house.
It is.
Yeah, it's on 1st and Chestnut Street.
Cool. I'm going to cruise by, definitely.
Okay, great.
Thank you so much for talking with me.
Sure. Take care.
Do you own a haunted house?
It's supposed to be haunted, but I've never seen the ghost in it.
But you'd be scared if you did.
I won't look for that ghost, no. Mm-hmm. I don't go wandering around at night, you know, trying to check it out. It's supposed to be the ghost of an old lady that lived in the house from 1867 all the way to 1930.
Friendly one? Or had she done anything violent?
A benign presence, I'm told, mm-hmm. by the last owners who say they saw her and that their children saw her.
Do you believe ghosts exist?
Yeah, I think they're there. I'm not going to fool around with them or try to invite them in.
Do you believe vampires exist?
No, I think vampires are mythical literary figures. I have never in all these years met a real vampire. I've met some knock-dead pretend vampires.
Knock-dead pretend?
Yeah, dressed to kill.
So if you have to go down in the basement of this home, you're going to turn on the lights, right?
Turn on the lights or get somebody else to go.
Wear one of those straps with a light right on your forehead.
That would be good.
Yeah.
That we don't have a basement, actually.
No, that's good.
Because we're Louisiana. Hmm. The basement would be a swimming pool. Yeah. You know.
Tim?
Yes?
You're on the air.
Hi, this is Tim up here in Northern Portland. Mm-hmm. And so happy to talk with you. Gosh, I've just started reading the Vampire Chronicles, and I was wondering, where did you get the idea for expanding the definition of the nature of a vampire? Because it seems like you understand more about that than anybody that's written about vampires ever.
Mm. It was instinctive, just sitting there at the typewriter thinking, well, okay, what's it like? What does it have to be like? What does he do at 4 a.m. when he's finished?
Right.
What music does he listen to? You know, what does he read?
You took the homosexual parts and even made them, it was easy enough to consider the idea, you know, when you put yourself in the place of, like, Louis,
mm-hmm.
Because of his nature.
Oh, well, that's great.
And it allowed me to kind of open up a little bit to consider the idea.
Mm-hmm. Well, that's wonderful.
This is so fascinating to talk to you and listen to you. I just picked up your books not very long ago, and I just finished Lestat, and I'm really looking forward to checking out some more of your books.
Well, you know, for me, when I'm writing, that sliding out of gender is completely normal. Once I'm in Louis' skin or Lestat's, I don't feel gender's important. And that happens over and over again as I write in almost anything I write. I guess I feel that really powerful people, really strong people, don't bother that much with gender.
Well, it's fascinating that you didn't have to get sexual to get the point across as well.
Well,
you could
true.
Almost feel like, you know, a hunger that was unhuman.
Mm-hmm.
That made it, you know, acceptable, you know, to the fantasy.
Mm-hmm.
Anyway, it was great to talk with you.
Oh, thanks a lot.
I'm just flabbergasted. Hootie hoo, guys.
Hootie hoo to you, Jim.
Thanks
more
for calling.
Brass.
Okay. What he was saying is very true. The logic, especially with the vampire thing, the logic that you have. Well, you shouldn't have given me that haul if I'm sucking down on it.
I was just going to give you a fresh one.
That you made everything logical because you're dealing with human emotions, even if they're dark, and even if we don't accept the fact that they're inside us, they are. Mm-hmm. And so to make them work, you have to make the characters work, so you have to make a vampire work, so you have to make logic. You have to, what is his or her life like?
Mm-hmm.
And that was really great. It's like great science fiction writers, you know, will write in the future,
mm-hmm.
but they'll make a logic to where we are now and how they got there.
Absolutely.
To make the story more believable.
Well, you know, it has to be about us. If it's not about us, it's a failure.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, it's not really just about vampires and witches. It just can't be. They have to be metaphors for the outsider in us, the monster in us, the obsessed.
Microcosms of our own situation.
Yeah, it's about us.
Cool.
Very destructive, that kind of thing.
Let's talk about that. All right, we're going to take a quick break, and we'll come back, and we'll finish up. We have a lot of other calls we're going to try to get to before we have to say goodbye to Ann. So if you want to get a call in, try to go ahead and call now, because we will try to finish these up before we go, because we promised you we would. So business...
The Mark and Brian program, 5 minutes to 10 o'clock. We're still here, and we're going to be here for a little while longer. She's going to stay a little extra.
Last Year is your latest book. Are you writing now?
Yes, actually, I am. I'm working on a book with Lestat and also playing around with some other projects.
Do you see another forum for your writing at some point in
another
the future?
Another forum?
Like right now, it seems as though you're. How many books do you have on vampires? Four?
Oh, I think four, and I'm working on the fifth.
So there's more to come in this subject.
Yes, but I also have a great desire just to write completely new kinds of supernatural novels. But I think I'll always stick with the supernatural. It obviously opens up things for me like nothing else.
Mm-hmm.
Why? I don't know.
But it works.
Yeah.
All right.
It does.
You know, all these callers, they're basically just so honored to speak to you. And do you like getting feedback, hearing from the people who read your books and finding out what they thought was incredible? Like Nicole was just telling you the two scenes in the beauty books.
I love it.
That she really likes.
I love it. It's what keeps me going. Mm-hmm. It's what saves my life.
Do you like being in the spotlight?
Not very much. I would rather be in my room in my flannel nightgown typing. You know, I really would.
Mm-hmm.
You know, drinking Diet Cola.
Tabbing
out. I'm kind of shy, but at this point, I really love seeing my readers. I think I'm really fortunate. It's not the whole response to these books is not screened for me by reviews and that kind of feedback. I directly see these people, even if it's for 30 seconds. You know, I get to shake their hand, look into their eyes. They say something about the book. I mean, to me, that's what the tour is about. Mm-hmm. It's the signings and these big groups of people and seeing. And they really give you the courage to keep going. I mean, and you're, it's like any writer, I have my dark periods when life seems utterly meaningless and I feel like killing myself. And, you know, they keep me going. They save my life. Mm. They say, yeah, you are still that weird little kid that was such an outcast in childhood, but we get it.
And not only do you get the feedback in book signings, but also from rock and roll stars when they write songs about your work.
Oh, I love it. Absolutely love it. Well, I'm a great music fan anyway. I'm slow. I move through things mm-hmm. very, very slowly, but I love Madonna, and I love Michael Jackson's different videos, like watching him dance, and I'm always watching MTV. And
did you enjoy Sting's song?
Yeah, mm-hmm. I did. And it was very generous of him to mention the book. That turned on a lot of young mm-hmm. kids to the books that hadn't heard of them. And that was kind of him, you know.
What do you read when you read?
Well, I read a lot of nonfiction. I read a great deal of archaeology, anthropology, true crime, political things like that. Really mostly that. Books on the first century, the history of religion, the second. Mm-hmm. Great pleasure. You know, my whole take on 20th century life has this... it's easy to write from the standpoint of an immortal or somebody out of time because I see the 20th century that way. Like I'm always seeing it in this perspective. I'm always thinking, oh, but think how bad it was in 1760 mm-hmm. when everybody had to carry a sword in the city or they got killed, you know? Mm-hmm.
You know, it doesn't appear as though in your writing you would live by this rule, the rule being you can't put out what you haven't put in, because who could have put in your descriptions of vampires and the way it is to become a vampire, yet you read a great deal, and in some mm-hmm. way you'll put that back out somehow. Mm-hmm.
What's important, though, I think, that you put in there is the emotional content. You put in what you feel, and that's not easy. I mean, there are always voices saying, water it down, don't make a fool of yourself, mm-hmm. you know, don't really tell them how badly that hurt. But if you do that, which I do, you run the risk of being an idiot, and you also run the risk of writing something very, very intense that proves to be intense for readers. So that's basically what I try to do at all times, is stay very uninhibited when I'm writing, mm-hmm. not be afraid.
When someone closes, reads the last page and closes the book of one of your books, what do you want them to feel?
Gee, that's a good question. Knocked out, you know, mm-hmm. like I feel when I finish a book that I truly love, like Sons and Lovers by D.H. Lawrence. I put that down and I thought, my God, I didn't like it.
Right.
But boy, was that a book.
Yeah, it's over now.
Was that a book, you know? That was incredible. Never forget that. That's mm-hmm. what I want them to feel. I'd like them to like it, you get
yeah,
it. But
right.
I mean, you
emotionally,
know.
You want them moved, but you
yeah,
want them frightened.
Yeah, I want them to feel a mighty book.
And
a
there's
book.
A lot more stuff out there
yeah.
than perhaps they're,
mm-hmm.
they've
when,
experienced.
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
When you're sitting at your terminal writing some novels or some things, do you know where it's going? Do you know mm-hmm. where the end is?
More than I'd like, but I actually... I'm getting greater and greater trust to write like I did when I was very young without knowing where it's going. A few books, I usually have a general idea of where it's going to go
do you ever feel
before
like
I start, but it changes.
Do you ever feel like you have no control where it's going? You're simply the fingers that type the words and...
No, because I change too much, and I get dissatisfied with stuff that doesn't feel authentic and throw it out. So I know I'm controlling it, but... There's a yielding, you know. I don't want to get into Sleeping Beauty, but there's a surrender mm-hmm. to this force in yourself that's very important.
Did you keep a diary when you were a girl, a little girl?
No, mm-hmm. but I do now. I have stacks and stacks of my handwritten scrawl all over the place.
Daily events or experiences,
yeah.
feeling?
Mm-hmm. The secret with a diary is to just keep going back to it even if you haven't for 2 weeks.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and my diaries are like that. They don't have date. I just date the page when I begin it, and I have diaries from 74 on, pretty much.
Can I have those?
No.
Okay,
one.
How nicely you asked the question. That's sincere.
Hello, you're on the air.
Morning, guys.
Morning.
Who do you
Barbara?
Anne.
Yes.
My most favorite character, the one I'm most interested in, is David Talbot. I haven't heard anybody mention him yet.
Oh, David, yes.
Can you tell me, is the Talamasca real? Did you think it up? Is it based on a real agency? And why did you do that to him in Tale of the Body Thief?
Why did I do that to him? I thought that was exactly what would happen. You know, I am Lestat, you have to remember. I can't be trusted. So, you know, Lestat and I...
You look nothing like I thought Lestat should look.
I know, well...
But you know, if Tom Cruise could play you with a wig, isn't that cool? You're about the same size.
I am, I'm short.
Wow.
Dark-haired.
Wow.
Yeah. There's an age difference, but the wig will help.
No, he can work it. He's a great actor. He can do it.
So the Talamasca, is it real or what?
No, I wish it was, but it isn't. But I'm writing more about it. I've already finished a third book about the Mayfairs, and there's a great deal about the Talamasca in that book. And I'm moving slowly toward the Talamasca book, you know, all about them and their members and their history and
so
everything.
So is that why David got younger? Now we have another 60 years to look forward to with him? He couldn't die, could he?
Well, no, David went where he had to go. So David will come back, of course.
I'm sure he will. Thank you. Thanks, Mark and Brian.
Thank you.
You bet.
Bye. Do you have any interest in UFOs, aliens?
Fascinated. Absolutely fascinated. Mm-hmm. I've been reading tons of those accounts of people have been abducted. Amazed. Read Colin Wilson's books on all of this all the time. I don't know what to make of it, except I know these people have been abducted. They believe it. They're telling the truth mm-hmm. about what happened to them. Now, whether it really happened
right.
or they imagined it or what, I don't know. It's fascinating.
It actually happened to them. They believe it did.
It did indeed. They are not lying. They are not deliberately trashing their lives and you know, by going public on this. And I love Bud Hopkins' books on that.
Do you feel a novel in that?
Yeah, I do.
That'd
I feel
great.
A novel in all kinds of things, you know. Once there's that sense that everything can be included, everything can be worked out if you trust.
Mm-hmm.
No.
You're writing a novel as we speak, aren't you? Just now, right now.
No.
You're not?
No, I'm right here. I really am.
Someone in the back of your head.
I'm not writing a novel.
I mean, people who know you, when you go to a grocery store, I don't know if you go under one.
I don't anymore, thank God.
With you there.
I have this really sweet kid, Susie, that goes to the grocery store for me. But anyway,
So you stop by and get gas or something, let's just say, okay. And the gas station that knows who you are might even know you personally. Mm-hmm. But, you know, if I was that gas station, I was thinking, all right, she's looking at these oil cans. That's going to be it. She's right. She's writing something right now.
It's going to be something for
something about lubing.
Wouldn't it be cool? Wouldn't it be cool if you're sitting at your terminal and you're writing, and you've talked about how you become that character and you kind of leave your body, and let's say you're writing about stomping through mud as a vampire or whatever, then you would have finished writing and you come back and you look down and there's mud on your feet?
Yes, that would be wild.
Stop it now.
Or there's blood trickling down your chin.
Right. Yeah, that would be even worse.
Yeah, for the feed.
Yeah.
It could just mean your gums bleed.
I got to get to the dentist.
One of the two. Take another call here.
All right, let's try... Did we talk to Chris on 7? Because this is an old...
Yeah, I think we did.
All right, let's do Felicia on 15.
Felicia?
Yes.
You're on the air with Ann Rice.
Good morning.
Good morning.
I wanted to let you know I read The Mummy when it first came out back in 1989 and let out a yell at the end when it said, "The Adventures of Ramses the Damned shall continue." Is it going to continue?
Yes,
yes.
I just haven't got back to it.
Okay.
You know, but I've had to let it brew in my mind. But I'm back with Ramses and Julie, and
kinds
of little things are happening. And you know, that book for me was a lark. It was a bit lighter than the other books. And I want to make the sequel like that, too. I want it to be like Jules Verne and H. Rider Haggard, you know, 20,000 Leagues Under the Sea. King Solomon's Mines, that kind of a great adventure.
Well, it was the first book of yours I'd ever read, and I was just thrilled with it. And like I said, when I got at the end, I got, oh, no, when? And it's been 4 years.
I know, I didn't plan to let it
lie
that long.
Didn't forget about it.
Okay.
Great news for me.
Thanks.
And it was a thrill to talk with you. Thank you very much. Who do you guys?
Who do you?
Love you.
You know, we've asked a number of questions. Love you. We've asked a number of questions today about where you are, how do you feel, how do you write, what are you wearing, the flannel and with the typewriter.
Mm-hmm.
The reason for that is because when you read your books, you're so much a part of it. I know when I read them, I think, okay, now I know, I'm trying to picture you in my mind when you're writing this.
Mm-hmm.
When you're writing and you have your assistant or whoever, do they knock gingerly on the door if they have to interrupt you, or are you pretty much a bear at that with that kind
Actually, they leave when I'm really working on a book. They don't.
They know not
they,
to.
Yeah, they do. I have a fax machine there, and they fax me from downstairs. If you can believe it, you know, like your sister called, you know, call her back.
Mm-hmm.
It's
so
that
they know
kind of
not
thing.
To interrupt.
Yeah, they're great at that. They're great in taking care of everything.
Yeah.
They're really wonderful.
How long can you write at one time?
Oh, boy.
If things are flowing good.
A couple of nights on this last book, I went round the clock. I took a break, walked around, and kept going. But I can't keep that up too long.
Yeah,
when I was younger, I could.
That's intense. I mean, that's really going. I mean, I'm assuming for 24 hours, you're going.
Yeah, yeah. Getting up, roaming around, getting a tab, dashing back.
The flow doesn't stop.
No. I was so excited, I couldn't sleep.
Yeah.
You know, so just never tried. I would say a good session is 12 hours. An okay session is 8.
Does it feel like 12?
No. Time disappears when I'm writing.
Do they slip pizzas under the door? Or, I mean,
Well, they sort of do that. They order the food, and I go down to the kitchen and meet with everybody, and we eat real quick, and then I go back up.
And you're back.
Yeah, I do take a break for that. I love to see my husband and son at that time. It's sort of when we get together.
So when you're not writing, can you say, I'm not going to write now for a month because I'm just going to not work. I want to go somewhere. I want to relax.
Or can you control that?
Oh, yeah. Yeah, to some extent. Yeah, definitely. For me, writing is like engaging. And until I get in there and engage, I just don't do it. You know, it's so I would say it's easier than I like to take the rest periods.
You ever been standing around, maybe at a family reunion or at a movie or whatever, and something just smacks you right in the head and you feel like you got to run out and do it?
Yes.
Do you?
Yeah, you mean in writing? Sure. Yeah. Oh, yeah, all the time.
You just go.
Things and just, I don't generally, though. I wait. I let it brew. And it'll come back and back in my mind.
So it doesn't go away.
It's a good thought. No, it will not. So I have a pretty good memory for that kind of thing. But there have been a few times and I've just dashed right to the word processor and, you know, shut the door and started going. I get inspired by all kinds of things. History, commercials on TV, a rock video, anything can do it. A bad horror movie.
Cool.
You know, I think, oh, well, you know, what about this, that, and the other? Dash in there.
You have, I'm assuming, so many things on the shelf just waiting to be done.
That's true right now. I'm fortunate. It won't always be that way, I'm sure. It's just like you've got to box while you can box, dance while you can dance. Mm-hmm. And there comes a time when you can't.
You know? Do you have a huge fear of writer's block?
No, I have no fear of writer's block. I have just the cosmic fears of being meaningless and it all being trash and the world blowing up. But, you know, I don't have any individual fear.
In that order, huh?
Yeah, sort of like...
Yeah. You got your priorities straight, huh?
Yes, right. And I do have friends who walk in and say, you know, the whole world is going to blow up, and that's really a bummer. Yeah.
How has
great
having...
friend. I'm working,
for God's sakes. How has having huge, unspendable amounts of money changed your life?
I don't know. I actually spend all the money I make. That hasn't happened yet.
All right.
I love to renovate houses. I just bought a 47,000 square foot orphanage.
Jeez.
And we hope to have our big vampire ball there next year in at Halloween.
And you're redoing that entire thing?
What are you going to do with it after the ball?
Well, we're going to use it for a whole lot of different things. Mm-hmm. It's going to be a great family compound, creative compound. We restored the chapel so that all the orphans can come back and see the chapel anytime they want.
Mm. That's cool. Now, I don't understand what you mean by family compound, creative compound. You mean for your family?
Yeah, my sister-in-law already lives in the building.
My sister
will have an apartment in the building. We'll have other quarters for different people who come to town. We have a lot of visiting family.
Can we come over?
Touring family. Certainly.
40,000 square feet, there's room for everybody.
Yes.
You do realize this is radio, and when you say it, everybody hears it, which makes it legally binding.
We're coming!
Like everything we hear on radio, right?
Going to head over to Ann Rice's house.
All right, listen, we know that you have to go. You have other stuff that you're doing. We're honored that you would take time to stop by and be with us and share with our original 43, who are mostly your fans, to call up and talk directly to you.
And for being so candid with us. You're fun.
Oh, well, thank you. This has been great fun for me, and thank you so much for reading the beauty books on the air and everything that you've done.
Yeah. And the beach.
Appreciate it very much.
On the air, on the beach.
And this is this
you know how this
like
conversation started? You should know this. This whole Anne Rice thing. We talked about you before, but not in as much detail as it happened. She came in after being having a weekend off, and she was on the beach, and she brought in the book. In fact, still had sand in it. Laying on the beach,
The Claiming of Sleeping Beauty.
Yeah, laying on the beach, reading this. She said that just laying on the beach, just reading the book twice.
Okay.
She had two.
Does the term sand wiener mean anything to you?
She did roll over at one point and find her a hump in the towel. And enjoyed that. But you brought her, and then she came in and talked about it.
And then we started reading it on the air.
Oh, that's great. That's great.
I had already read the vampire books before I ever picked up one of the Sleeping Beauty books. And as a big fan, I just want to say thank you, because you've given me many, many hours of pleasure. Not just on the, you know, the erotic side.
Yeah.
But I love your work. And
have you met Louis?
I actually have.
All right, thanks again.
Thank you
very much.
Take care. All right, gang, we're going to bail, too. We'll be back on the Tuesday, hopefully rainless, at 6 o'clock. Well, I guess we need the rain, so fine. But we'll be back tomorrow morning. We have several things we have to get done. Notice how last week we told you that sometimes we'll bring stuff up and not get around to it. Remember the Caesars thing we have to get around to? Maybe tomorrow.
We're looking maybe January.
We'll do it.
Be good human beings. Thanks for joining us today. We'll see
you. Rock and roll, 95.5.